have seen movies that have been like, you're not going to believe the twist at the end. I'm like, I can believe this, but this shit?
Hi, and welcome to Normal Gossip. I'm Kelsey McKinney, and in each episode of this podcast, we're going to bring you an anonymous morsel of gossip from the real world. We have a great episode this week, but first, a quick reminder that you can subscribe to Normal Gossip at either the friend of a friend or friend level for $5 or $12 a month. If you subscribe, you get access to an extra episode each month featuring a listener. And if you subscribe at the friend level, you can be entered into a pool to be that featured listener. You can subscribe at supportnormalgossip.com. Friends also get access to our close friend circle on Instagram and discounts on Normal Gossip merch and live shows. Okay, joining us today is Tracy Clayton. Tracy is one of Normal Gossip's absolute favorite writers and podcasters. She's the host of many podcasts, including Back Issue, the Netflix podcast Strong Black Legends, and the interview podcast Going Through It. You also might remember her from the amazing podcast Another Round. Tracy will be performing at California Sunday's Pop-Up Magazine this spring, so get tickets to that. Alex and I are going to. Tracy, thank you so much for coming on the show. I'm thrilled to have you here.
Thank you so much for having me. This is an honor because there's finally a monument to just regular ass gossip because it's one of the best parts of life. And I'm just so happy to be here in this institution.
Oh my God, great. Well, classic first question for you. What is your relationship with gossip like?
I love gossip. I love gossip so much that in my free time on YouTube, I watch old episodes of 90s daytime TV talk shows, which were so juicy. I'm not talking about like the which ridiculous. Ones? Yes. So not like Jerry Springer and like all of the, you know, none of that. Mm-hmm. Ricky Lake for sure. An amazing talk show.
Oh, hell yeah.
Jenny Jones, not so much because she also got into a lot of the like really ridiculous theater, like, you know, half-dressed teens say they can do whatever. That's not what they want. That's not what I want, right? The absolute best places you should go for early 90s TV talk show drama, Forgive or Forget with Mother Love. Do you remember that talk show?
No. Forgive,
so
I'm
absurd.
Writing it down.
The drama is just so amazing, and it's like perfectly low stakes because, number one, you don't know these people. Number two, it's like decades ago. So, you know,
incredible.
The distance that you have emotionally is perfect. But the concept of the show, right, somebody comes on the show. It's usually about three guests, and each guest has an issue or like a thing that happened. And there's somebody that they need to apologize to or seek an apology from, right?
Got it.
So they're on stage, they tell their story, then they walk over to this really big, like, door that they have. And they're supposed to open the door. And if the person forgives them, they'll be on the other side of the door. But
oh, my God.
There's nobody
there. I do remember this show. Oh, now that you've described that visual, I do remember the, like, double doors.
It's so intense. My favorite story so far is one about there was a girl who brought her sister and her cousin on the show because both her sister and her cousin slept with her boyfriend.
I'm like enraptured.
Right? And she's demanding apologies and they won't give her an apology for sleeping with her boyfriend.
Like they're both exactly. Like, nah, I don't.
They're both like, no, I'm
that's
not gonna
on
do
you.
It. Yeah. And then she was like, well, she flirted with a man that I wanted a while ago. And she was like,
what?
A crush is not the same thing. And I'm just like, why isn't the boyfriend on the show apologizing? It's so much. It's so good. It's just a perfect little morsel of,
oh my God.
Of gossip. It's a good way to burn anxious energy at the end of the day. I love it.
Wow. I can't wait to lose my entire weekend to this.
There are so many episodes on YouTube. So many. I can't wait till you get into it.
Great. What about you personally? Do you consider yourself like a gossip in your real life?
I don't think I do. I've never thought about that. I don't. Okay, let's unpack this. I don't consider myself a gossip because I am not typically the person who is like out spreading and like telling stories.
Okay.
I am usually the recipient of said stories. Mm-hmm. Let me say it this way. In the event that like there's danger afoot,
sure.
Right? If like I've heard like there's this person in this mm-hmm. industry, you should stay away from this person and that person. Then yes, but I don't consider right. that gossiping. I consider that like trying to keep myself and my folks safe. And actually, this is something that my friend Nicole Perkins pointed out. A lot of the hate and flack that gossip gets is because a lot of it, you know, is like a whisper yeah. network to keep people safe. You know what I mean? And to right. tell you the things that the people who are oppressing you probably don't want you to know and won't tell you themselves. So that aside, I don't have to know the people in the story. Like, I've got a group chat and I'm just like, you know, what's the latest gossip? What's mm-hmm. going on? I don't have to know these people or anything. And I find that it's a good way to bond mm-hmm. with like my very, very close support group and support system mm-hmm. and just like my closest friends. It's got everything, right? It's got laughter, it's got drama, yeah. it's got memories. And I will say that an ex of mine,
okay,
I know, right?
Love
where's
this.
It going? Where's it going? So I could say a lot of bad, clearly, because he's an ex, but one of my favorite things about this particular ex is that he was so into gossip. Oh. And we
That's
could just
really
like
cute.
Scroll through Twitter threads together, like, oh my gosh, did you see this one? Did you see that one? And like, it just really felt like we were one in those moments,
That's
you know?
So nice.
Even though it didn't end up, you know, whatever, it was very refreshing to have someone to enter into that space with.
Yeah,
I think.
Super nice.
Yeah. A very surprisingly nice thing.
Yeah, a love braided together by other people's drama. Just
yeah,
what everyone wants.
Exactly, exactly.
Tracy, my next question to you is an ode to Another Round, your old Ooh. Podcast. And I would like mm-hmm. to ask you a question you asked often, which is, tell me, how do you feel about squirrels?
Oh my gosh, still hate them. I don't know how many years it has been, but they're still just completely horrible. And I don't appreciate that my Instagram algorithm or whatever keeps giving me squirrel videos.
What?
I don't know.
What kind of squirrel videos are you getting?
They're supposed to be cute, but they're not cute. They're not cute at all. There's this one video that I kept seeing, and it was like this squirrel, man rescues a squirrel, and the squirrel like wouldn't like... He just wouldn't be released into the wild.
Like
the squirrel
like that.
Kept coming back. Right. And they were just like, oh, it's so cute and sweet. And I'm just like, this is harassment. This is possibly a crime. This is not cute. This squirrel could have rabies. You don't know what he's thinking. You don't know his ulterior motives. It's just terrible. And recently I saw that they had like chewed through like some really important cables somewhere
what?
Or something. Yeah.
These squirrels are trying to destroy the internet? Absolutely not.
Name one like good historic squirrel that's ever done anything good. You can't. Pigeons have saved people. Squirrels, only drama, only pain. So I still hate them. Thank you.
Okay, good. I'm glad to know that that has not changed.
The one part of me that is consistent will be that.
Something I've realized is that people don't always think about physical symptoms like headaches, teeth grinding, even digestive issues as like indicators of stress. Like if you're not sleeping enough or you're sleeping too little or you're like never eating or you're eating too much, that can like all be stress. You know, I like noticed a lot of these symptoms myself when we were producing the first season of Normal Gossip. I was just stressed all the time trying to balance my entire life and like this show and try to make something that we were really proud of and that you would love. And that's part of why we took this long break is to like give ourselves time to reset. And one of the ways that you can like take care of yourself and help yourself manage your stress without taking a break off of work is by trying some therapy. A good way to try therapy is through BetterHelp. BetterHelp is customized online therapy that offers video, phone, and even live chat sessions with your therapist, so you don't have to see anyone on camera if you don't want to. It's much, much more affordable than in-person therapy. Give it a try and see if online therapy could maybe help you lower your stress levels or even help you with other mental health issues. Normal Gossip listeners will get 10% off their first month at betterhelp.com/normalgossip. That's BETTERHELP.com/normalgossip. Okay, Tracy, welcome back. It's time.
Thank you.
It's time to do gossip. It's time to get into it.
I'm so ready to do some gossip.
Okay, great. So today's story takes us into a terrifying, messy world full of tears and kicking.
Oh, God.
Are you ready, Tracy, to join me as we bury ourselves in the land of children's soccer?
Oh, man, I feel like this could get rough. I think so. Let's go.
Okay, so this is neighborhood gossip, but it's also preschool gossip. Because in this community, all the families are, like, really connected. There's a hippy-dippy preschool a couple blocks away from where our main character, Alicia, and her wife, Sandy, live.
Okay.
Alicia, they, like, moved to this neighborhood before their daughter was born because they specifically wanted to join this, like, hippy-dippy children's cooperative. This preschool is extremely exclusive or something that I don't really understand. But the preschool starts in August. They're thrilled.
It's like Montessori.
Exactly. Exactly. That's what it means. In May, the preschool, because it has like too much time and all of these parents are too invested, adds all of these parents for the incoming class to a Facebook group so that they can talk to each other.
Okay.
This is theoretically helpful because they can start like organizing and stuff. Do you have any do you have any feelings about this before we continue?
What are we organizing? I think I'm trying to imagine the same thing happening with the public school system that I was in. It would just be like, what do you want? What is this for? What are we carpooling? No.
The public school system is like, we need to organize a drive to buy scissors for the classrooms.
Right. Not enough Kleenex, guys. We need more boxes of Kleenex.
Okay. So the Facebook group is like pretty tame throughout the summer, just like sharing community pool times and supply lists and other stuff. Mm-hmm. But right before school starts, Alicia decides to post to the Facebook group for the first time. Okay. They've lived in the neighborhood for 4 years, and every single fall, this giant man, I'm talking like 6'5" at least, biceps the size of my thigh, teaches a preschool soccer group in the park near their apartment. Alicia has been obsessed with this man because, one, it's really funny to watch a guy this big try to teach a bunch of preschoolers, and two, it seems to be like that he's really good at soccer. Mm-hmm. Alicia was like a competitive soccer player. So she's like, I can tell that this guy's extremely good and I want to watch him try to like teach my daughter to play soccer for my own amusement.
Okay. Okay.
She went up to him last fall. He gave her the link to sign up. Whatever. She posts the link in the group. This is her first post. They fill up the whole section. All these kids in the preschool. In the meantime, before the soccer season starts, the group has its first drama.
Oh my gosh.
Here we go. Okay. Alicia's college friend, Bailey, and her husband, Scott, are also in this group for their child.
Okay.
You know, Alicia's like her best friend from college. They're very close. And Scott is the man that she married.
Okay. So there's not any connection really beyond this is the person that my really good friend chose. And so
exactly.
I acknowledge him when he's around.
Exactly. Okay.
Cool.
Alicia hasn't been a huge fan of Scott for two reasons. The first is that he hugged his brother before he hugged Bailey at their child's very outdated gender reveal party.
Wow, there's a lot that you just gave me.
Break it down.
So, like, once the whatever color means whatever.
Yes, exactly.
Flavor of baby that you ordered and are getting. He's so happy that he hugs his brother in that moment.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a boy then, I'm guessing.
I'm not sure, actually.
It was a blue. Interesting.
But does it matter?
No. No, it does not. It doesn't at all. Okay. All right. That's a good reason to look at somebody, like, a little sideways.
Mm-hmm. So that's her first grudge. Her second grudge is that Scott is, like, the kind of guy who, like, always leaves his dish on the table for someone else to grab.
No.
Like, even at Alicia's house.
No.
And she's like, I know this is such a small thing and that my friend loves him, but I can't and I will not let this go.
If he's doing that at your house, then I'm sure he doesn't touch a dish at his own house. And how dare you make my friend do all this
exactly.
dumb shit.
Yes.
Don't like it. Exactly. You should at least pretend that you're going to, you know,
at
walk
least
a
in
dish
front
someplace.
Of other people.
Right.
Pretend
like,
that
oh,
you do housework.
Go ahead and you got it. Oh, OK. You
exactly.
know, something.
Okay, so she's already, like, not on Team Scott, right?
Right, I see.
But she's becoming even less of a fan of him now that they're in this Facebook group because Scott and another dad, Jason, are in an all-out, unjudged competition for best dad that exists.
Oh, no. What does that even mean?
Well, I'm going to tell you. The first drama we will call the Great Plato Calamity.
Oh, my gosh.
On the second week of school. There is a parent meeting to discuss a fundraiser. For the fundraiser, the parents have been asked to, like, donate stuff that they have so that it can be, like, silent auctioned off, right? So people have donated, like, sports tickets or, like, coupons to their businesses, you know, stuff like okay. that. Mm-hmm. Jason, the other parent competing with Scott, is really mad because his donation to the auction has been rejected.
Oh, my God. What was it?
Well, I'm going to give you some background first. I just, like, need you to understand that this is a group that is involved in what our friend of a friend who gave us this story called competitive parenting. So, like, if they're having a birthday party, the cake is homemade. If they're having pizza for dinner, it's homemade. If their child is going to play with toys, they will be like those artisan wood ones with no color. Their baby will, like, speak Spanish even if they don't, right? Their baby will be well-versed
first
in
words.
Every liberal baby book that exists, right?
They'll have the anti-racist baby book that they were talking about.
Exactly.
Are babies racist?
Exactly. What Jason has donated for his family auction is homemade Play-Doh.
Mm-mm. Why? Nobody wants that shit.
So of all the parents, Jason and his wife Ruby are, like, the most hippy-dippy.
Okay.
Not only have they made their own Play-Doh with, like, cream of tartar or something, they have also used plants to make, like, colored dyes.
You know what? You could have saved so much energy and time. Go to Walgreens, get some Play-Doh. How performative!
Strong agree. The school, Alicia learns from a Facebook post, also agrees with you because they have been like, you know what? We're not going to use this for the auction. We don't want to auction it off. Exactly. So Jason, Play-Doh Jason, has written in his post on the Facebook group that, like, they haven't returned his Play-Doh. Right. So he's like, you know, fine. It's, like, kind of rude that you won't accept my Play-Doh for the auction, but you could at least, like, give it back to me. Like, we worked hard to make it. And he's like, has anyone else had this problem? Like, is anyone else's auction thing missing?
No, Jason, we didn't make Play-Doh out of flour and try to pass it off as a prize.
Exactly. Alicia probably would not have noticed this if her wife hadn't been like, Scott has responded to this post, and you need to see it.
Oh, my God. Let me guess. Can I guess?
Yeah, please.
Scott was like, yeah, I've had the same problem. They also wouldn't accept my homemade organic rutabaga Hot Wheels cars that I carved by hand with organic toothpicks. It's outrageous.
No, Scott has gone with the opposite approach, and he's like, can you chill out, dude? It's just Play-Doh. There is no reason for you to make this into some whole drama.
I'm confused because he's right.
I know.
But I don't like him. What do I do with
these
feelings?
Confusing. I know. Play-Doh Jason has responded back, quote, well, it might just be Play-Doh to you, but some of us have lived in this neighborhood for decades and don't have big fancy baking jobs that can subsidize bigger gifts.
What?
So now what? People are picking sides, right?
Whoa. It is. Surely nobody's on Play-Doh Jason's side. Surely not.
Listen, I can't speak for parents, but some of them are. And there is like a divide growing. No one is discussing Play-Doh Jason's post. Like, they do not care that he wants his Play-Doh back. What they're discussing is Scott's energy in response to it.
Oh, so they thought he was being too harsh and aggressive?
They're like, this is a preschool group, dude. Like, chill out. You chill out.
Wow. I hate everybody in this group, maybe.
It's going to get so much worse. Okay. So while Alicia is reading these posts, right, and, like, talking to her wife about him, Scott's wife texts her and is, like, freaking out. She's like, is Scott the villain?
Oh, no. He's from the TikTok. Is it, am I the villain?
Exactly. I'm the villain. Alicia is like torn because she's like, you know, I don't think that this is that big of a deal, but also I do think he's the villain, like for other reasons. So I don't really
generally, yes.
In this specific action, no, right? And we also have to remember that Alicia is like super excited about this soccer thing that her child's gonna learn soccer. And she's like, all these other parents are supposed to come. I already told this like big soccer dude that they're all going to be there. So like what I don't need is chaos.
Oh my gosh, they're going to fight. They're going to fist fight over play.
What do you think she should do? This is the first of many. What do you think she should do in this scenario?
Oh my gosh. Okay. Okay.
You're all Alicia.
Right. Move maybe? I don't know. Okay, so let me let my brain get a linear picture of this. Mm-hmm. So there's Alicia and Scott, who is a terrible person, but also right in this instance.
Yes.
But that doesn't even matter because the preschool parents have completely turned it into something else.
Yes.
And everybody's on sides. It sounds like there's not a team. Everybody is dumb, so everybody should stop. Is mm-hmm. that an option maybe?
Mm-hmm.
Regardless, now everybody's going to meet up to see a 7-foot-tall man teach 2-foot-tall humans how to kick ball. And maybe the parents will have a huge civil war.
Yeah.
Honestly, I say write it out. Live tweet it at me. I want to know. Put this on TikTok. Maybe it goes viral, and then you get some endorsement deals, somehow. I mean, you gotta recognize when something is out of your hands is when what my therapist would say. You know?
Wow. Yeah, she sounds smart.
Toss it up in the air. You know, whatever happens, make the best of it.
That's basically what Alicia the decision she comes to. She's okay. Like, you know what? I'm just gonna stay out of this. What I'm gonna do mm-hmm. is I'm gonna tell Bailey to tell her husband to log off. And stop posting. And I'm going to post at the top of the Facebook group tomorrow and be like, don't forget soccer practices this weekend.
Should she put like hashtag good vibes only?
Right. Exactly. Exactly. So the next week goes fine. Jason's Play-Doh gets returned by the school.
Thank
Bailey
God.
Keeps Scott off Facebook. It is now time for soccer.
Oh my God.
Okay, so it's bright and early. It's Saturday morning. The parents have all come out with their like coffee cups and their sunglasses. They have on their like leggings. They've been hyping up this to their kids all week, so the kids will like also be excited. Uh-huh. The soccer balls are like so big compared to the kids, so everyone Aww. Loves this.
Oh, that's so cute.
Everyone is here. Play-Doh Jason is standing on one side over by his kid, way on the other side of the park. Alicia's husband, Scott, is standing on another side of the park. Everyone is just like here waiting for the giant tall man to show up and teach the children.
Oh my goodness.
Bailey comes over to Alicia and is like, I sent Scott over to apologize to Play-Doh Jason.
That feels like a bad idea.
Sure enough, Alicia looks over there, and there's Scott and Play-Doh Jason standing off to the side together with their baseball hats pointing forward, not looking at each other, but talking. They're doing that thing where their legs are spread apart and their arms are uh-huh. crossed, so they both look like big capital letter A's.
Yeah, like when an owl tries to make itself really big. Oh, my God.
Alicia's like, you know what? That's great. I'm so glad they're going to work it out. She's like, why is Scott so intent on fighting Play-Doh Jason? Like, what is his deal? And Bailey's like, well, you know, Scott lives on our street, so they have a bit of, like, neighbor history.
Oh, I didn't consider that they had already interacted before mm-hmm. the Play-Doh incident. So it wasn't about Play-Doh for Scott at all.
Exactly.
Ooh.
So Alicia is like, because she's nosy, is like, what kind of history?
Uh-huh.
And you are going to hate this.
Oh, my God.
It is a whole thing. Bailey's like, it's this whole terrible thing. But basically, the alley behind our houses that we share has a squirrel problem. There
it's
are
the squirrel's fault the whole time.
So many squirrels. And the squirrels are menaces. What? The squirrels taunt the dogs, and then the dogs are barking. They drop
they
extra
do.
Leaves into the pool. They're like low-key aggressive to everyone.
They throw shit. They throw acorns at you.
Exactly.
And they just like they stalk you. Okay. A minute.
Okay. So both Play-Doh Jason and Scott think that they're the only ones who can solve this. Like squirrel dear. Problem. So that is the like root of this actual drama, right?
I can I just pause for a
please,
second and say
please.
That I hate men so much sometimes. So clearly, the thing to do is unite against the squirrels. Yes. Who cares whose plan is better? You just want to get rid of the fucking squirrels. Yes. That's it. I own the prize. But no, you got to be like, well, my squirrel killing plan is bigger than yours is.
Ugh. Exactly. Ugh. And it's like,
and if meanwhile, squirrels just taking over everything.
Meanwhile, the squirrels are just repopulating, creating more drama. Awful.
Wow. I'm physically upset at this point. I really am. I'm so angry at both of them. Oh, my God.
Alicia's like, listen, this is a cute story, but the big soccer coach is here and he's starting to talk. So, like, I can't hear any more about this stupid fucking squirrel drama. So she, like, trots over to where the big soccer coach is. And he does what, you know, every teacher does, where he's like, count off. One, two, mm-hmm. one, two, one, two. He's like, one's over here, two's over there. Right? Mm-hmm. So the kids are now in two groups. You two, he points at Alicia and Bailey. You go with the ones. You will be my assistants. Oh, dear. You two, and he points at Plato, Jason, and Scott.
No.
You will be my assistants for the twos.
Oh, my gosh.
Do you think that someone should intervene here?
Clearly. Okay. Yes. Because everybody knows and understands the significance of this pairing up, right?
Yes.
And nobody was like, well, Mr. Man, maybe we could. This is some suggestions.
Yeah. Every parent is just like, ooh.
This feels like that. I don't know if you're into horrible brain rotting reality.
Oh, I sure am. Yep. All
wonderful. So, you know, that episode where like two people have been fighting the whole time and then there's like an event and they're very clearly paired up together just to see what kind of drama.
The producers are like, it's time for the 2-on-1 date. Which of you will he choose?
Yes. That's clearly what's happening. Is the tall man in on this? Did he do this on purpose?
I don't think so.
Does he know Plato Jason from the before times? Now I'm just conspiracy theorying.
I mean, now that you know about the squirrels, you know, anything could be possible.
Wow. Okay. So I'm with it.
None of the parents intervene. They're all like, hee hee. Right. For most of us, learning a second language in high school or college wasn't exactly a high point in our academic careers. I went to a performing arts high school, and technically I took French, but I think mostly I learned to count to 10 and how to convince our French teacher to order us pizza to the school. Now, thanks to Babbel, the language learning app that sold more than 10 million subscriptions, there's an addictively fun and easy way to learn a new language. Whether you'll be traveling abroad, connecting in a deeper way with your family, or you just have some free time, Babbel teaches bite-sized language lessons that you actually use in the real world. I've been taking Spanish lessons for a few years, and Babbel has been a great supplement to that. Babbel's 15-minute lessons make it the perfect way to learn a new language on the go. Other language learning apps use AI for their lesson plans, but Babbel lessons were created by over 100 language experts. And you can really tell because you learn the vocabulary very quickly in my experience. If you want to say gossip in Spanish, that's chisme. Their teaching method has been scientifically proven to be effective. With Babbel, you can choose from 14 different languages, including Spanish, French, Italian, and German. Plus, Babbel's speech recognition technology helps you improve your pronunciation and accent. There are so many ways to learn with Babbel. In addition to lessons, you can access podcasts, games, videos, stories, and even live classes. Plus, it comes with a 20-day money-back guarantee. Love that. Start your new language learning journey today with Babbel. Right now, you can save up to 60% off your subscription when you go to babbel.com/gossip. That's babbel.com/gossip for up to 60% off your subscription. Babbel, language for life. Alicia, like, immediately forgets about this because she's busy doing her, like, assistant coach stuff.
Right,
and she's
right.
Like, these kids can, like, barely move the ball. Like, this is so funny. This is the best time I've had in a long time. Like, they're trying
sounds adorable.
It's really cute. They're, like, trying to move it around the cones, but, like, uh-huh. They can't because the ball's, like, up to their waist. And Alicia's like, this rules. Like, I'm having the best time. Aww. I was right. Like, everyone is here. What a good morning. Tiny goals are, like, brought out, and each kid tries to, like, put the ball into the goal. Aww. Like, they can't do it. It's perfect. Everyone it loves
sounds,
it.
It sounds like the puppy bowl that they have during the
exactly. season. It's exactly like that. So by the end of the practice, Alicia is like, this is just, I am having the best day, right? Like, aww, everything is coming up, Alicia. I'm watching all of these little kids. I'm so happy. So she's standing with her wife and with her friend Bailey when Scott comes up. And Scott returns from the other side of the field, like, clearly pissed.
Oh, my God.
He's like, it was a mess over there.
What the hell? What happened?
Exactly. So they're like, what happened? And Sandy, Alicia's wife, is like, well, I'll tell you what happened before Scott tells you. Basically, Scott was being super bossy, and Plato Jason was trying to keep everyone happy, but neither of them were listening to the main coach.
So the
parents were mad at, like, Plato Jason because he's distracting the kids, and Scott because he's telling them to do something else. Sandy's like, Plato Jason, you know, clearly was a camp counselor. Scott, like, clearly never got to be one, right?
Oh, shit. What a terrible dynamic.
That's the vibe, right?
Oh, awful vibe. Bad vibes only, in fact.
Alicia's like, whatever. Like, I cannot be brought to care about this. I'm going to happily come to these practices every Saturday. And if you don't want to come, like, good luck to you and good riddance. So a few weeks go by. Obviously, as you can guess, this is getting worse.
Oh, my God.
Scott's family gets a new outdoor patio.
Oh.
Then Plato Jason's family gets a new outdoor patio.
But bigger, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm assuming.
Exactly.
Mm. Made of all organic imported wood from Morocco.
Yeah, they built the clay with their hands, fired it in the oven. At Scott's child's birthday in October, there's a whole group of face painters. The next month at Plato Jason's child's birthday, there's a whole troop of clowns. It is truly just like all out war of the parents.
Oh, my God.
The whole time, Scott is like whining about this to all of these women, and none of them could be brought to give
Nobody
a shit.
Cares.
Everybody's
wow.
like, whatever. Like, leave Plato Jason alone. Stop being so, like, annoying to everyone.
Right. Get over it.
But everyone kind of starts to believe him because
to believe Scott?
Yes, because Scott's family gets chickens, and 3 days later, Plato Jason's family gets chickens too.
Okay, wait. All right. Okay. So for a second time, I have to be like, I kind of agree with Scott. I mean, as a fan of chickens,
yes.
I don't think a neighborhood can have too many chickens.
Okay.
But, I mean, I feel like this is just, like, refutable evidence, Your Honor. I mean, like, if had Scott not gotten the chickens in the first place, I mean, it's just impossible to think that Plato
yes.
Jason would have just randomly popped up with some chickens. Also, why did they get chickens?
I have no idea. And it's not like I asked follow-up questions to our friend of a friend that called us in. I'm like, where do you live? Right? Like, I'm like, where are you? And it is not like they live in the middle of the wilderness or, like, a small town. Like, these families live in a mid-sized city. They, like,
wow.
share an alleyway. The chickens are, like, messy and smelly. Their feathers are, like, floating into people's pool.
And I'm sure that the squirrels are harassing the chickens.
Exactly. So you would think that this would drive Plato, Jason, and Scott to become allies.
Yeah.
Like, to protect their chickens. It does mm-hmm. not. They each blame each other for, like, the chickens making noise too early in the morning. They're like, my chickens are the good chickens. It's
Please
Plato
shut up. They're
Jason's
chickens.
Fault.
They are all chickens. They probably knew each other before they got to you. They're
exactly.
like, oh, hey, Hattie, what's up? We getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning, girl. You know it. Okay, see you. This is now the chickens are in it. This is just horrible.
It's obscene. So
Poor
they're
chickens.
They're all, like, being civil, though. Like, no one is mm-hmm. fist fighting. No one is yelling.
What a low bar.
I know.
Nobody has been file drafted yet.
When 2 weeks later, one of Scott's chickens is killed.
Oh, my God.
Scott is immediately convinced that Plato Jason did it.
Oh, my God, he did it.
He's like, Jason killed my fucking chicken.
Oh my God.
I've been telling y'all that he's been acting weird. He cannot be trusted. Mm. Like, he killed my chicken.
I mean, things have been escalating to a more ridiculous point. But let me posit this.
Please.
What if it was the squirrels? I don't put it past them. I don't put it past them at all. The squirrels are probably just like, watch this, watch this. We really gonna fuck them up this time. Kill a chicken, and then they just gonna go crazy.
Okay, so 2 days after the chicken is killed is soccer day again. So they're all at soccer day. All the parents, like, know that this chicken has been killed. All the parents know that Scott thinks it's Play-Doh Jason.
Does Play-Doh Jason know that Scott thinks it's Play-Doh Jason?
Before practice even starts, Play-Doh Jason is like, I want to be clear that I did not kill Scott's chicken. I am 99% positive that it was the squirrels. They have been tormenting me and all of us for weeks. It was them.
So now I agree with Play-Doh Jason. This is too much for me to handle.
Okay, so unlike you, I did not know how bad squirrels were. So I was like extremely skeptical of this claim. I was like, I don't think that squirrels kill chickens. Like, that seems not real. Mm-hmm. Maybe you already know this. It seems like you do, but squirrels do in fact kill chickens.
I didn't know that, but I assumed it and I was right.
You were right.
That's terrible. Oh my God.
It's so rude. Okay, so I learned from a very reputable site called squirrelenthusiast.com that squirrels will attack chickens if the chickens have something they want, and that they're also known to steal eggs and steal baby chickens.
Oh my God. Why would they steal a baby chicken? What would they do with it?
What are they doing with it?
Surely they don't eat baby chickens.
Here's a direct quote from squirrelenthusiast.com. Oh my God. These cute furry creatures are from the rodent family, and their large incisors and molars can tear through baby chicken. Ever heard this statement? Quote, squirrels are rats with nicer clothes? Looks like there's some truth to that. This is the site that's pro squirrels. Like, they are the squirrel enthusiasts.
See? Wow. Oh my gosh. This is so much.
Okay. So everyone is like, you know what?
We're still not done.
We're not done. Everyone is like, you know what? All the parents are like, you know what? It does seem kind of reasonable that the squirrels killed Scott's chicken. Like, we think that that's reasonable. Scott does not believe Play-Doh Jason. Scott is like, not for 1 second. After practice, Scott comes like blazing over to his wife and Alicia, like rattled. And he's like, Play-Doh Jason is a monster.
He's a murderer.
He told me that he was going to kill the squirrel. And what? I laughed to appease him or whatever. But then his like voice changed. He was going on and on about how normal American families are so pathetic. They just like call animal control and have a squirrel caught in a trap and let free and not him. All the women are just like looking at each other, right?
He's going to get killed by a squirrel is what's going to happen. He's going to go out there, try to kill a squirrel and get his ass handed to him. And that's that.
All the women are like, whatever, Scott. Like, we do not care. This makes Scott madder. He starts yelling. Scott's like, Play-Doh Jason said, we're going to murder that motherfucker. He said he was going to put antifreeze on honey. And he said, air quotes, to eat it from the inside out.
That's weird, first of all. Secondly, what if the chickens eat it?
I know. I know. Scott is like super upset. He's like, Play-Doh Jason is going to hunt the squirrel with a crossbow. You really think this guy didn't kill my chicken? He absolutely did. This is like high-key sociopathic behavior. Do you want him coaching our children?
Oh, my God.
They are still at practice.
And the kid's like, Dad, watch this. I need your attention. She's like, later.
Scott's like, no. Play-Doh Jason. So what do you think that the women of this group should do?
Kick both of them out of the group, of the neighborhood, of their spouses' lives. off the planet if that's an option. But also, though, send the squirrels. I really think that maybe the squirrels might be, like, complicit in this whole thing. I think they're probably smarter than I give them credit for. And they eat baby chickens. What wouldn't a squirrel do, you know?
Wow. So do you think that, like, Alicia should confront Scott or, like, respond to this diatribe?
I don't know. So Scott is the spouse of Alicia's good friend from college.
Exactly.
Has Alicia tried talking to her good friend from college about it since the whole he's going to kill everybody with a crossbow thing?
Good question.
And what did that yield anything? Can she maybe have the friend talk to Scott? I mean, he doesn't seem like the type to listen to anyone, let alone his spouse. So,
I mean, you're 100% on the right track. Alicia is like, I thought I told you to fucking get him in line. Like, this is a disaster. She's like, please talk to your husband. Like, deal with him. She's also like, I just cannot talk to Scott, right? Like, I'm so mad at him. He's yelling about crossbows at practice. Like, I can't do this. Yeah. Yet again, the talk among the parents is not about Plato Jason.
Right.
It's about the fact that Scott is accusing Plato Jason of planning to hunt a squirrel with a crossbow.
He's planning the genocide of all the squirrels by hand.
Exactly. Okay, so a few days later, someone is, like, walking in the alley, like, taking their little trash out. Mm-hmm. And there is, like, a good amount of blood on the ground.
Plato Jason's dead.
No, it's dead.
Okay.
But they're like, this could be the chicken, right?
Uh-huh. Like the chicken that was previously
killed. Exactly. Okay. But in their head, they're like, but it could also be that Plato Jason really is hunting squirrels. Oh, right? They're God. Like, this I don't know what to do with this. Something else.
Right.
So the parents of this group come to Alicia. They're like, you're friends with Bailey, who's married to Scott. Can you please figure out what's going on here? And Alicia's like, Scott has ruined all of his credibility for me. Like, I'm not sure if I believe him. I'm not sure what he's even talking about. I never liked him to begin with. So, like, I can't do anything here. But the parents are, like, kind of scared and freaked out. Like, they're like, I don't like that these men are yelling at each other. I also just don't like the idea of someone shooting a crossbow in our neighborhood. Like, that makes me a little uncomfortable.
Right? Very fair.
Exactly. They're like, Alicia and Sandy, your child is friends with Plato Jason's child. Can you please be delegates and go talk to him? Do you think that they should go to Plato Jason's house to, like, be delegates for the other parents?
You know, I'm trying to put myself in Alicia's situation. I would feel away. I'd be like, listen, this is a grown man who pays taxes, I'm assuming, and makes his own decisions. I did not birth him. I did not marry him. How is this on me? How is this my fault and my problem? I would say maybe, like, some form of, like, small, intimate group intervention should happen. Like, get them both in a room and be like, yo, listen, we both really appreciate your passion. Whatever you have to do to soothe their egos before you tell them to shut the fuck up. And just be like, you're bumming us all out. Mm-hmm. There are babies here. This is the point. We're here for the kids, not for killing squirrels. Although, I mean, I feel like it's a tab you could open if that was your thing. But, you know, like, just chill out, or you got to go. What I would hate to see happen, though, is either one, it just makes them matter. And then they're just like, Plato Jason's getting my kid kicked out of the group. Right. And then da 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 da. I don't know what else you could do at one point, aside from being like, listen, we're going to have to take a kid out of the thing because you're being too much of a distraction. I would hate that for the kids.
Right.
But what are the other options if they just won't behave?
Right. So you're in exactly the same frame of mind as Alicia. Good job. You, like, got yourself right in there. Because she's like, again, her number one goal is to watch the children trip over balls that are the same size as them.
With this 9-foot tall man
trying to, like, herd them into, like, choreography or something. So she's like, okay, what I'm going to do is, like, my friend is friends with Plato Jason's child. So I'm going to go over there with my child for, like, a little play date. And I'm going to get, like, a feel for the situation from his side, because I only understand what's happening with Scott. right? So she's like, I need more information, right? Mm-hmm. So she goes after school, like low stakes. The kids disappear upstairs to play. The house is like lovely. It's like clear that they care about it and are like doing projects mm-hmm. On it. And Alicia's like, I'm going to bring up this situation.
Uh-huh.
She's like, here's the thing, Plato Jason. Scott told everyone, essentially, that you said that you were going to kill squirrels with a crossbow. And now a bunch of people are really freaking out and super worried because they don't want people shooting crossbows in their neighborhood. And they also don't want squirrels dying.
Uh-huh.
Plato Jason, like, looks immediately very upset.
Uh-huh.
And he, like, leans forward and he's like, I really do not know why Scott would say this about me. Like, I thought that we had worked out our conflict. Now he's doing this. Here, I'll tell you exactly what I told him. Oh, my gosh. And he, like, kind of, like, moves his body a little bit and he mm-hmm. changes his voice. And his face changes, and Alicia is watching it, and she's like, oh, clearly he's doing an impersonation. Like, he's clearly being someone else. And he says everything that Scott said, right, about, like, mm-hmm. the antifreeze and the crossbow. But he's, like, clearly doing a bit, right? Like, it is clearly a stand-up routine.
To be funny.
And Plato Jason is like, this is a real comedian's bit. Like, I'm just quoting a bit that I think is really funny. Like, have you heard of this comedian? Oh. Have you heard this bit?
Oh, my fucking God.
And they're like, no, we haven't heard this bit. But, like, but we believe you. Like, it's not like you're funny enough to have come up with this rhythm, right? Like, they're like, oh my God, Scott really is just like creating drama. And she's like, okay, so you don't have a crossbow? And Plato Jason's like, well, I mean, I do have a crossbow, but it's like this one that's on the wall, like from when I was a kid.
But is it functional, Plato Jason? Is it?
Well, I mean, how do you feel about this?
I feel stressed out. I feel like
I'm still trying to figure out, like, who.
Everybody's fucking nuts. Yeah. I don't know. Everybody is
shit, man. Okay, so all right. So the revelation that this was a bit and he was trying to be funny.
Mm-hmm.
Does give me some comfort that maybe he won't be, like, the next one featured on, like, a true crime podcast for some shit that he's done. After he delivered this bit, though, did he laugh? Was he like, ah, I'm just kidding, it's a George Carlin thing?
Because maybe it's
I feel like if you're going to do a bit and deliver it, either you're just not funny or you didn't. You know what I'm trying to say? Like,
exactly.
Why wouldn't anybody know that you were joking?
So this is, like, basically the conversation that Alicia and Sandy have on the ride home, right? Where they're like, okay, he didn't do the bit that well. But he did laugh at the end of it. And it was, like, clear that he was doing an impersonation. They were like, so we really think that, like, if we had been in this situation, we would have been like, what are you doing? And not Scott is going to hunt squirrels with a crossbow. Right.
Okay. That does make sense.
So they're like, you know what? We really think that this is a Scott thing. Like, we think that Scott is creating chaos. We think that he's doing this because he hates Plato Jason. We think he's just desperate to be the best dad. And Plato Jason is his direct competition. And he is so embarrassing. And all we want to do is, like, chill out and play soccer. All I want is to have fun. Okay, so now Alicia is convinced that Scott is full of shit.
Yeah.
What do you think she should do with this? Because, like, Bailey is her close friend, Scott's wife.
Yeah. Jesus. Okay. All right.
So, I think your advice to move at the beginning was really the correct advice.
You know, just eject Scott. Maybe divorce is the only answer. I don't know.
And, like, you know, not to to be a bummer, but I mean, this shit could impact the child, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, as they get older and more cognizant of shit, you know,
You don't want somebody's kid to be like, I heard your daddy was a Play-Doh Jason and he was killing squirrels and now we don't want to play with you no more. You know? But I mean, it seems clear that something has to be done to focus everybody and recenter attention on the kids and make sure that shit is safe for them. Because I'm not sending my kid to the house of a man who said he was going to kill squirrels with a crossbow, even if it was, seeing how I feel about squirrels, mm-hmm. I might. But the crossbow part does get me a little bit. I feel like at this point I would have to start looking for, okay, who else do we complain to? Like, there's got to be mm-hmm. a high... you need to speak to the manager at this point.
Okay.
I need to speak
who's
to the manager.
Who's the manager, though, of a friend group?
I don't know. That's the thing. That is the thing. And how do you, like, eject him without there being ripple effects for the rest of the family?
When you say eject him, which one are you mm-hmm. talking about? Scott or Plato
Great
Jason?
Question. Great follow-up. I'm talking about Scott.
Okay.
Primarily. Because, I mean, you just can't. You can't do mm-hmm. this. You can't do all of this for your own personal vendetta and reasons. It's selfish. Nobody wants to be around you if you're going to do that.
Exactly.
And so, I feel like a thing that the world is missing these days is consequences, because everybody yells cancel culture as soon as somebody is just like, well, you committed this offense and here's the result. Don't cancel me because cancel Plato Jason, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah. But, there's... God forbid I face a consequence of my own action.
Exactly. Because that's not why I'm here. That's not why I was born. It's not what I'm on this planet to do. But there's got to be some form of consequence, because he's not going to stop on his own. He just isn't going to stop.
So Alicia takes it into her own hands. She's like, I'm the manager now. She's like, I think that this has gotten out of control. It's not happening anymore. It's not happening at my special soccer time. I will not allow this anymore. She tells her friend Bailey, she's like, listen, I talked to Plato Jason and like, I really think that Scott is not right on this, right? Mm. Like, everybody needs to just call a truce mm-hmm. on the parenting Olympics. And like, Scott and Plato Jason are not invited to the soccer games anymore until they are like capable of getting their shit together, because this mm-hmm. is just not appropriate or okay.
Right, right.
Okay, so this works. After this, things like calm down. They don't go to soccer. Everyone kind of like yells at them separately, right? Like everyone's getting, both of these men are getting yelled at because everyone is like, can you please stop?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Things are like really calming down. The soccer season finishes. The squirrels are like less of a problem. The children are having fun. There's peace in the kingdom. Everything is fine.
Oh, wonderful.
How do you feel?
I feel like the other shoe's coming soon. The other shoe's gonna drop.
Before we get there, who do you think the villain is?
Scott. Well, I think it's the squirrels, and I also think that it's Scott.
Tell me why.
The squirrels off here.
For both. Tell me why for both.
Well, squirrels eat baby chickens, so mm-hmm. fuck them.
As we've learned, yeah.
As we have learned. That's really upsetting.
It really is.
I love chickens so much. There's a chicken on a farm in North Carolina that's named after me, and now I'm just like, is she safe? Is my daughter safe?
You're like, get the squirrels away from her.
Right. I gotta send a text message and follow up now. But I mean, it seems that Scott is so laser focused on Plato Jason and him being the problem and the villain and not able to take himself out of that, to the point that everything that happens, he's going to see it through the lens of this motherfucker is he did it and he's terrible and it's awful. So I think that he is co-villain along with the squirrels.
Okay. Would you like to hear the end?
Yes, please. Oh, my gosh. Oh my gosh, if my internet like went out right now, I don't know what I would do. I just got so scared.
The listeners can't see this, but Tracy's sitting in a completely dark room. So like, if your internet went out, I don't even know that
you would,
I would be like, is she here? Okay. About 6 months after this whole debacle, we have been mm-hmm. like drama-free in Eden, right? Everyone is calm. Everyone's doing well.
Uh-huh.
Scott and Plato Jason have made up. They're like still helping with sports things. They've returned to the soccer. It's all good.
Oh, good.
Uh-huh. Plato Jason and his family are going out of town for Christmas. And they're uh-huh. like, Sandy and Alicia, can you please come feed our chickens while we're out of town?
Oh, no.
And they're like, absolutely. We would love to feed your chickens. They're super cute. Like, happy to check on your house.
Uh-huh.
On the last day of their visit, they like come after school. So they bring their daughter with them. And she like goes upstairs to her friend's room to play, right? While Alicia and Sandy put the trash cans out on the street for like the trash pickup or whatever. They call her downstairs to go. And on her little head is perched a clearly homemade hat made of a squirrel.
Is that true? Is this the true story?
Yes.
What? Oh my God. Wait. Oh my God. He was right the whole time.
He was right the whole time.
Oh my God. And he made a hat. That is some psychopath shit. He made a hat out of the squirrel. Oh, lock him up. Call the police. Oh my God. I don't know what to do right now.
We have like seen the text message threads because what Sandy and Alicia did in this moment, I respect just like chef's kiss. Think that this is perfect. They took a photo of their daughter wearing the hat and group chatted it to like all of the parents.
Oh my God. Yo, I have seen movies that have been like, you're not going to believe the twist at the end. I'm like, I can believe this, but this shit?
I know.
This is dark. Oh my God, this took a turn. Oh my goodness.
It was Play-Doh Jason all along.
Fucking Play-Doh Jason. Wow. Wow, Play-Doh Jason. Had everybody going for a minute.
He really did.
Oh my gosh.
Tracy, is there anything else you would like to say before we log off?
I need to go lay down. I need a drink. It's 3:17 in the afternoon.
It's time to have a beer.
I don't care. Yeah. You know what? That wow, this was an I can't believe it. Can we do like a welfare check on the rest of the Play-Doh family? Yes. Are they okay? Like,
I will find out.
Holy fucking shit.
Tracy, thank you so much for coming on the show. It was an absolute delight to have you.
Thank you for having me. I think, but the rest of my day is done. It's shot,
yeah, we should have warned you.
Wow. What the fuck?
Thank you for listening to Normal Gossip. If you have a gossip story to share with us, email us at normalgossip@defector.com or you can leave us a voicemail at 2679-GOSSIP. If you love this podcast and want us to keep making it, become a friend or a friend of a friend at supportnormalgossip.com. You can follow me on all social media at @McKinneyKelsey. This podcast was produced by Alex Sujong Laughlin. Defector's projects editor is Justin Ellis. Our editor-in-chief is Tom Lay. Thanks to the rest of the Defector staff. Defector Media is a collectively owned, subscriber-based media company. Thank you to Gabby for sharing this gossip story with us. I'm Kelsey McKinney, and remember, you did not hear this from me.
My father's like, listen, we're gonna murder this motherfucker, huh? We're gonna put antifreeze on bologna. What? Why, Papa? Why? Because it eats the intestines. That's why.